knows a lot about the science stuff. Professor Dave explains.
Over the past few tutorials, we have been discussing catalytic hydrogenation reactions, meaning the addition of hydrogen gas to a number of double bonds, chiefly carbon-carbon, but also carbon-nitrogen and carbon-oxygen. Now we will discuss another important application of hydrogen gas, its reaction with nitrogen gas to produce ammonia. As we know, living organisms require nitrogen to biosynthesize key biopolymers like proteins and nucleic acids. The single most abundant source of nitrogen on Earth is nitrogen gas, which makes up slightly over 3/4 of the air we breathe. Unfortunately, most living organisms are unable to utilize this source of nitrogen. The molecule consists of two atoms of nitrogen bound by a triple bond and has a bond dissociation energy of 945 kilojoules per mole, which makes it one of the strongest bonds we know. There are microorganisms which are able to fix nitrogen to ammonia using enzymes called nitrogenases and using ATP as energy currency. These are called diazotrophs. Unfortunately, however, higher animals have not evolved this ability. We are most definitely not diazotrophs. Ammonia is actually a very toxic molecule to most living organisms. It is a toxic gas under ambient conditions with a boiling point of negative 33 degrees Celsius, and it is not found in appreciable amounts in life. Diazotrophs capture ammonia as glutamate, and this storage reaction forms the basis of amino acid and nucleoside synthesis. Once introduced into glutamate, the amino group can be exchanged with a number of substrates to effectively transfer ammonia using enzymatic reactions. Ammonia is excreted as urea or uric acid in higher animals, again because ammonia is too toxic to be tolerated in appreciable concentrations in vivo. Due to its toxicity, there are no bulk sources of ammonia in the animal world. Sources of nitrogen include nitrate minerals and guano, the excrement of seabirds and bats. Yet ammonia, which is used to make fertilizers, is needed in huge amounts to sustain modern agricultural production. Therefore, an industrial process to convert nitrogen gas into ammonia has always been a target. The first practical version of this process was invented by German chemists Fritz Haber and Carl Bosch at the beginning of the 20th century. Actually, the driving force for this development had to do with the weapon industry, which relied on nitrates. Nitrates were not available to Germany, and therefore Haber and Bosch were tasked with finding a solution to the unavailability of large enough sources of fixed nitrogen. The basic equation for the process is as follows, with one molecule of nitrogen reacting with three molecules of hydrogen to yield two ammonia molecules. The reaction is exothermic under ambient conditions, with a delta H at room temperature of negative 46 kilojoules per mole, and therefore the equilibrium favors formation of ammonia. Unfortunately, the reaction does not work under ambient conditions, even in the presence of the best metal catalysts. Using the traditional iron-based catalysts, a temperature over 400 degrees Celsius is needed to achieve reasonable conversion rates, and under these conditions, the equilibrium becomes unfavorable since additional heat drives the system back towards reactants via Le Chatelier's principle. To better understand why this is the case, we need to recall that what truly drives chemical reactions is Gibbs free energy, which means not just enthalpy, but also entropy, as illustrated by the equation delta G equals delta H minus T delta S, and the entropic contribution becomes more substantial at higher temperatures, since the change in entropy is multiplied by temperature. For a spontaneous reaction, delta G has to be negative. Delta H is indeed negative for the reaction, but delta S is also negative. The entropy decreases in the reaction because we start with four molecules and end with two, and a decrease in entropy makes the reaction less favorable, and at high temperatures, this entropy term overwhelms the change in enthalpy to make the process non-spontaneous. To get more quantitative, under typical pressures of 150 to 200 bar, the two terms cancel each other out around 200 degrees Celsius, and therefore the equilibrium is unfavorable under typical conditions, or the temperature of 400 degrees Celsius that would typically be used. However, a way to force the reaction forward was discovered. One trick that can be used is to increase the pressure. Higher total pressure favors the forward reaction because we are turning four molecules into two, so Le Chatelier's principle dictates that the products will be favored in order to alleviate some of the pressure increase. High pressure requires a large energy expenditure and has safety issues, as in practice it is difficult to run the process beyond the 200 bar threshold. Under such conditions, ammonia constitutes only 15% of the gas mixture at equilibrium. The most important trick we can use is to recycle. We have to keep in mind that the relative boiling points of the three species involved are as follows. Nitrogen is negative 196 degrees Celsius. Hydrogen is negative 253 degrees Celsius. And ammonia is negative 33 degrees Celsius. This means that if we flow the gaseous mixture through a catalyst bed and cool the effluent to a temperature that is under negative 33 degrees Celsius, but not as low as negative 196 degrees Celsius, much of the ammonia gas will condense to a liquid and can be collected in a receiving flask, while the hydrogen and nitrogen gases will be recycled through the reactor bed. This also drives the reaction forward via Le Chatelier's principle, as we are removing the product as it forms. If the process is repeated several times, very good conversions, usually in excess of 90%, are obtained. This is the basis for the current Haber-Bosch process, which is still used to make ammonia industrially. Each year, about 230 million tons of ammonia are prepared by this process. Obviously, a lot of attention is paid to improvements. One obvious way to improve the process is to optimize the catalyst. Here, we are doing heterogeneous catalysis, and even without changing the catalytic metal, it is possible to improve the process by better catalyst fabrication or improving the quality of the surface. Lots of attention is paid to reducing fouling, which slowly degrades the performance of the catalyst and requires catalyst reactivation or replacement. Iron is the key metal used simply because it is so cheap, and the final product has to be extremely cheap, but other metals like ruthenium work even better. In addition, non-transition metal salts are added, and this affects the catalytic power of the surface. There are drawbacks to this key process. One is energy consumption. Ammonia production on Earth accounts for around 2% of global energy expenditure, which means more than the entire air travel industry. CO2 emissions related to the ammonia production process represent 3% of global human emissions. But the area that is attracting the most attention is the use of alternative, greener sources of hydrogen gas. Hydrogen is currently produced through gasification of hydrocarbons, mainly natural gas like methane, and 3-5% of the methane produced in the world goes toward making ammonia. This is a huge amount. Independently of ammonia production, cheaper approaches to hydrogen gas production are therefore being sought. To briefly mention current implementation plans, it is envisioned that by 2026, ammonia plants using electrolytically produced hydrogen, meaning produced from water, will have a global capacity of 240,000 metric tons per year, which is equivalent to 0.1% of global demand. Thus, the century-old Haber-Bosch process will not be easily supplanted. Finally, you may be curious to know what the mechanism of this reaction looks like. Because we are discussing a heterogeneous reaction under conditions of extreme heat and pressure, you can imagine that experimental work with this system is not trivial. However, given our detailed knowledge of catalytic surfaces and the very simple nature of the intermediates involved, theoretical calculations have probed the intimate details of the reaction. We cannot possibly cover this extensive, specialized field in detail, but we can qualitatively describe the accepted classical mechanism as consisting of several basic steps. In the first step, the reactants diffuse toward the catalytic surface, and in step two, they are adsorbed, meaning they form weak bonds with the surface. In step three, nitrogen is split into two nitrogen atoms, which are tightly bound to the metal and have been described as metal-nitrene complexes. This is usually the step requiring the high temperature, which means it is the rate-determining step because of the strength of the nitrogen-nitrogen bond. In steps four and five, it is hydrogen's turn to adsorb and split into two hydrogen atoms. In step six, there has to be diffusion of the hydrogen atoms so they reach reacting distance with nitrogen atoms. And finally, NH bonds are beginning to form. We transition from FeN species to FeNH, and then FeNH2, and finally adsorbed ammonia, or FeNH3, which in step 10 begins to desorb and return to the gas stream. To conclude, although this reaction is a bit different from the more mild reactions we will discuss in the series, because it operates under extreme temperature and pressure conditions, we must keep in mind that this is one of the most important reactions at industrial levels. We have already discussed the enormous production volumes. Industrial ammonia production has allowed us to increase crop productivity dramatically, allowing us to feed much of the Earth's population by using only 15% of the Earth's surface for agriculture. It has been calculated that at least 50% of the entire nitrogen stock in our bodies comes from the Haber-Bosch process. No wonderful industrial process comes without drawbacks. We discussed the enormous energy consumption and must also mention atmospheric pollution due to the emission of nitrogen oxides. Because of these and other drawbacks, scientists are working hard at improving the process, applying greener hydrogen, reducing formation and release of pollutants, and decreasing the energy expenditures by designing more effective and more durable catalysts.
Thanks for watching. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.